can be the best. You can be the King Kong banging on your chest. You can beat the world. You can beat the war. You can talk the guy, go banging on his door. Hi, this is Dr. Perry Carpenter. I'd like to thank you for taking the time to join me on today's video. Today's video is all about a special topic that I want to share with you about the activities of daily living assessment. Today we're going to concentrate on the activities of daily living assessment. And the material that I want to share with you today is extracted from one of our QME continuing education home study programs. And specifically, it's extracted from the program entitled 21 Secrets of the Most Persuasive QMEs. And this program has proven to be our most popular program. And over the weeks and months since we released this program, I've begun to receive calls from doctors requesting additional elaboration on some of the topics in that program. So that's the purpose of today's video, is to elaborate on one of the topics contained within that 6-hour QME Continuing Education Home Study program. And I want to tell you just a little bit about the 21 Secrets of the Most Persuasive QMEs program. That's a program that contains 21 of the best practices, the best QME examination practices of some of the most respected and most persuasive qualified medical evaluators in the entire state of California. And I can say that with certainty because I had the opportunity to interview some of these well-respected qualified medical evaluators, and I asked them to share with me some of their best practices, some of their tips and techniques and procedures that they use in order to produce qualified medical examination reports that are credible, that are substantial, and above all, that are persuasive. And I collected those secrets, and I started to study those procedures and organize those procedures, and the procedures started to parcel themselves out into four basic categories. Category number one is the preparatory secrets of the most persuasive QMEs. Category number two is the interview and examination secrets of the most persuasive QMEs. Category number three is the report writing secrets of the most persuasive QMEs. And then category number four is the deposition secrets of the most persuasive QMEs. And on other videos, I've completely elaborated on all the secrets in category number one, the preparatory secrets of the most persuasive QMEs. I've already handled that. Now we're beginning category number two with secret number one of the interview and examination techniques of the most persuasive QMEs. And today I want to talk to you about how the very best evaluators in the entire state of California handle the activities of daily living assessment. And just to give you a little heads up about the philosophy of what we're going to talk about today, it's my opinion, and it's the opinion of some of the best evaluators in the whole state, that the activities of daily living assessment needs to be a formalized procedure done in the face-to-face evaluation with the injured worker. And many times the activities of daily living assessment is sort of done as an afterthought, and it's done as a informal procedure, and not much attention to detail is given to the activities of daily living assessment. But the AMA guides actually require that we do an activities of daily living assessment in the production of our opinion on permanent impairment percentages. And we'll talk a little bit more about that here as we go. So the very best evaluators do the activities of daily living assessment in the face-to-face evaluation with their injured worker. They don't simply provide the injured worker with some questionnaires in the mail and ask them to bring those questionnaires with them to the appointment. They don't simply have the injured worker complete a series of check box checkbox forms in the waiting room prior to the evaluation. The very best evaluators consider the activities of daily living assessment equally as important as the physical examination. And I'm going to share with you several reasons why that is so. Why the activities of daily living assessment is at least as important as your findings on physical examination in constructing your impairment, your opinion on permanent impairment. So today we're going to talk about how to do the activities of daily living assessment, and we'll review what the AMA guides require us as evaluators to do and to consider as relates to the activities of daily living. So what I'd like to have you do is I'd like to have you join along with me here by getting your AMA guides, because we're going to read from a couple of sections out of Chapter 1 that talk about the philosophy of activities of daily living. So let's take a moment now. I'd like to ask you to go ahead and retrieve your AMA guides, and I'll get my AMA guides as well, and I'll join you right back here in just a moment. You can beat the clock, you can move a mountain, you can break rocks, you can be a master, don't wait for luck, dedicate yourself and you go find yourself. Standing in the Hall of Fame, yeah, and the world's gonna know your name, yeah. Okay, I'm back with you now, and I have my AMA guides with me here, and I hope you have your AMA guides with you as well. Because I'd like to ask you to follow along with me as we go over several sections in the AMA guides that describe our obligation as the qualified medical evaluator in considering the impact of our examinee's injury, condition, pain, symptoms, etc., on their ability to complete activities of daily living. So I'd like to draw your attention, first of all, to Chapter 1 of the AMA guides, and specifically on page 4, in the very beginning of the chapter, and this comes out of section 1.2 of Chapter 1, and Chapter 1 is all about the philosophy of the guides. So interestingly is that at the very beginning of the book, in the very first section of the very first chapter of the book, the guides review the importance of activities of daily living. And I want to emphasize that to you now so that you will start to place more emphasis on your own activities of daily living assessment. And as I said in the preface today, the activities of daily living assessment should be a section of your report that is very thorough, that is very detailed, that is very accurate, and it should be a section of which you can be proud to include in your finished product of your QME report. Because trust me, if you've ever been in deposition, you know that the activities of daily living assessment sometimes becomes a focal point and a pivotal point upon which the parties will question you when it comes time for you to defend and support your opinion on permanent impairment percentages. So the activities of daily living needs to be at least as thorough and at least as detailed as your physical examination. And I'll point out here as we go that the activities of daily living assessment and the physical examination really go hand in hand. They fit like a hand in glove in supporting your opinion for your permanent impairment percentages. So the activities of daily living assessment is as important as your physical examination. And sometimes, depending upon the number of body parts that may be involved with your particular case, your assessment of activities of daily living may even take as long as your physical examination. And I'll illustrate that with some examples here as we go. But let's now read from Chapter 1 of the AMA Guides, beginning here on page 2. And let's describe some of the distinctions between impairment, disability, and impairment ratings. Okay, so those are three separate subjects that we want to clarify here. And the guides begin the entire book by clarifying those topics for us. So let's begin here. It says on column one, on page two, states that the guides continue to define impairment as a loss of use, or a derangement of any body part, organ system, or organ function. Let me say that again. Impairment is defined as a loss of use, or a derangement of any body part, organ system, or organ function. So let's just dissect that definition here for just a minute. An impairment is a loss of a body part, organ system, or organ function. So what would constitute a loss? Well, how about an amputation? How about where the arm is amputated below the elbow? That would constitute a loss of a body part, okay? Impairment is also defined as a loss of use of a body part, organ system, or organ function. So what would qualify as a loss of use? Well, as an example, how about a person who presents with ankylosis of the wrist? Imagine a person with their wrist in extension ankylosis. That would represent a loss of use of the wrist for activities that involve wrist flexion. That would be an example of loss of use, partial loss of use of the wrist, and that would qualify as an impairment. And then finally, the guides describe impairment as a derangement. Okay, so we have loss of use, or any other derangement of a body part, organ system, or organ function. So those are the qualifications for impairment. Okay, so now we're going to take impairments and translate impairments into impairment ratings. And that's really the job of the qualified medical evaluators, to describe the impairments and then to translate those for the parties into permanent impairment percentages that are then compensable under the workers' compensation system. Okay, so let's investigate impairments a little bit more. And we're going to provide a link or a connection between impairments and activities of daily living. And then we're going to take those two connections, or those two links in the chain, and put it together in formulating our permanent impairment percentage opinion. Okay? Now, further down in the same column on page two of the guides state that an impairment may lead to functional limitations or the inability to perform activities of daily living. Now, that's an interesting quote, because the guides say that impairments do not always lead to functional limitations, and they do not always lead to inability to perform activities of daily living. It states here that an impairment may lead to functional limitations, or it may lead to the inability to perform activities of daily living. As what we're going to see as we go on here, that even though we find an impairment in our examinee, if that impairment does not cause functional limitations, if that impairment does not cause an interference with activities of daily living, then by definition, that impairment does not qualify for a permanent impairment rating. So it's kind of interesting that we identify impairments, the loss of use, or derangement of body parts, organ system, or organs functions. We identify this with our physical examination. That's how we identify the impairments. But in order to provide an impairment rating, We then need to combine our findings on physical examination with our findings on activities of daily living assessment to come up with an accurate construct of the permanent impairment percentage. Okay, and that is, and that illustrates the importance of the activities of daily living assessment. Okay, let's continue. Now on page 4, chapter 1 of the AMA guides, still talking about impairments. Okay, on the bottom of column 1, page 4, the guides state that anatomic loss receives greater emphasis in the musculoskeletal system, such as in measurements of range of motion. Okay, so losses of range of motion represent anatomic losses. And we use many different types of measurements when assessing the musculoskeletal system for anatomic losses. We use strength testing. We use circumferential measurements. We do range of motion testing. We do reflex testing. And all these different measurements we use in the musculoskeletal system to assess for anatomic loss. However, as opposed to anatomic losses, functional considerations receive greater emphasis in the mental and behavioral section. So let's summarize that. With the musculoskeletal system, we're mostly focused on anatomic losses in identifying the impairments. In the mental and behavioral section, we're mostly concerned with identifying functional losses. And why is that? Why is that? Why the distinction between the two systems? Well, when we consider the mental and behavioral impairments, many times those impairments are untraceable to any specific anatomic loss. So for example, you can have a person who sustained a head injury and is left with some functional losses, but by physical examination and even with sophisticated diagnostic studies, there's no anatomic derangement identified. But in the musculoskeletal system, much easier to identify the anatomic loss. So this quote here illustrates the interplay between anatomic considerations and functional considerations. And it's the functional considerations that we unearth and identify through our activities of daily living assessment. Imagine someone with a mental and behavioral impairment. How would we identify the impairment in the absence of some functional limitations? There is no identifiable anatomic loss or derangement. We identify those impairments on the basis of the functional limitations. So there's this interplay between anatomic losses, such as loss of a body part, loss of use, of a body part or an organ system or an organ function, and the functional considerations, which basically translates into the impact of the anatomic loss on activities of daily living. Now, it's our job as the evaluator to then translate the impairments into permanent impairment percentages that the parties can use in the workers' compensation system. So let's see what the AMA guides require of us as evaluators with regards to providing permanent impairment percentages. And this comes out of second column on page 4. The guides here state that impairment percentages or ratings are estimates that reflect the severity of the medical condition and the degree to which the impairment decreases an individual's ability to perform common activities of daily living, excluding work. Impairment ratings were designed to reflect functional limitations and not disability. Disability is a term that we reserve for and inability to compete in the open labor market. Impairment percentages, on the other hand, describe the effect of an impairment, a loss, loss of use, or derangement, on the individual's ability to perform common activities of daily living, excluding work activities. Work activities would qualify as disability. And it's possible to have an impairment, but actually not to have no disability. And I'll give you an illustration of that principle here in just a minute. So the whole person impairment percentages that are listed in the guides estimate the impact of the impairment on the individual's overall ability to perform activities of daily living. And the AMA guides provide us with table 1.2, wherein they illustrate what they consider to be the common activities of daily living of importance in considering when rendering our opinion on permanent impairments. Now, it is possible to have an impairment and to have no permanent impairment rating. It is possible to have an impairment and have no work disability. And let me just illustrate that principle. And this is an example that I just observed yesterday. yesterday, I was at the Walmart. And for those of you that have seen some of my videos on YouTube, you know that I derive much of my material from my observations of people at the Walmart. It seems that Walmart provides us a good cross-section of the American public, and you can always observe different people there with medical conditions and all kinds of things going on down at the Walmart. And specifically, I notice at the Walmart, I frequently observe people that have gait disturbances. It's not unusual to see people there with canes and crutches and walkers and wheelchairs and all kinds of conditions that impact their gait. So anyway, yesterday I was at the Walmart and I noticed that my cashier at the Walmart had some sort of stiffness in his elbow. I noticed that he was not able to fully straighten out his elbow. And so I asked him, what happened to your elbow? And I asked him, did you crush your elbow or what's going on with your elbow? And he told me that his elbow had been like this from birth because he was told that at birth he was born with a condition known as Bell's palsy. And I thought about that for a minute and I said to him, well, I don't think that's Bell's palsy. Bell's palsy involves the face. And he thought about that and he said, well, my doctor told me that at birth I was born with Bell's palsy. Or maybe it was cerebral palsy, he said. And he really wasn't sure what was the cause of this condition. But on further investigation, he stated that at birth, his entire side of his body was in spasm, was spastic. And they were able to do some surgery to release the wrist. In other words, he has some range of motion of the wrist, but the elbow remained ankylosed in flexion. So this is an obvious impairment. And if you think about your upper extremity examination in chapter 17 of the guides, we could project what could be the impairments associated with this man's right elbow. There's a loss of range of motion impairment, probably loss of strength impairment, probably some atrophy impairment. He also had a wrist drop. In other words, he had no wrist, no strength in wrist extension. And so there was probably some neurologic impairment as well. And all these different impairments of his right upper extremity. And yet, here is a man who works 8 hours per day, 5 days per week, 40 hours a week as a cashier. And he's able to compete successfully with all the other cashiers, the very best cashiers, and he does a fine job as a cashier. And so this impairment does not interfere with his ability to perform his functions as a cashier. So this is an example where this impairment is not work disabling. And there's probably many other examples of this circumstance that you can come up with out of your own case files. And the guides themselves, they talk about this specifically on page 5 of the guides, bottom of the first column. They state that a 0% whole person impairment rating is assigned to an individual with an impairment. So the individual has an impairment, but we assign a 0% impairment rating. So we have he has the impairment, but we assign a 0% impairment rating when the impairment has no significant organ or body system functional consequences and does not limit the performance of the common activities of daily living that are described in Table 1.2. Okay? Now, in contrast to that, a very high permanent impairment rating, such as a 90 to 100% whole person impairment, indicates a very severe organ or body system impairment, requiring the individual to be fully dependent on others for self-care. And this is a condition that is approaching near death, because this is an individual, that is an individual with a 90 to 100% whole person impairment rating. This is a person who's completely dependent on others for activities of daily living. And if we stated that another way, we would say that this person has almost no capacity for performing their own activities of daily living. So this illustrates the importance of the activities of daily living assessment, because it's the activities of daily living assessment that really add substance and add the meat, so to say, to the permanent impairment rating. Because as the guides state very clearly here in the philosophy section, we can have a bona fide impairment, but if there's no impact on activities of daily living, then it does not qualify for a permanent impairment rating. And so to use our Walmart cashier as an example, this is an example where the individual had a bona fide impairment, probably multiple impairments, but it's not work disabling. In other words, he works 40 hours per week very successfully as a cashier. Now, if we were to explore his activities of daily living, we might find some deficits, and we probably would. And in that case, he would qualify for a permanent impairment rating. So thus the importance of the activities of daily living. And really, it's the activities of daily living that provides the permanent impairment rating, because it's the physical examination that identifies the impairment, but it's the activities of daily living assessment that unearths and uncovers and discovers the impact of the impairment on the person's functional activities. And it's the functional activities, or the functional activity losses, that provide the basis for the permanent impairment percentage. Okay? So now I'd like to go over some of the mechanics involved with performing the activities of daily living assessment. And as I said earlier, the activities of daily living assessment is something that needs to be done in the face-to-face evaluation. The very best evaluators consider the activities of daily living assessment at least as important as the physical exam, and they give it just as much time and just as much attention and just as much investigation as they do the physical examination. So the activities of daily living assessment consists of two separate and distinct cycles of action. The first of which is the symptom questionnaires. And the very best evaluators go through the procedure of providing the injured worker with symptom questionnaires during the face-to-face evaluation. Now, many doctors do not do it this way, and it seems that there's about as many ways to go through the symptom questionnaires as there are doctors doing evaluations. But the very best evaluators do a procedure very similar to the following. And that is, they provide the examinee symptom questionnaires after substantial interview and after getting a feel for the impact of the injury or condition on the individual's activities of daily living. That's the point in the evaluation that the very best evaluators select the appropriate symptom questionnaires and provide those questionnaires to the examinee in order to allow the examinee the opportunity to respond to specific questions and to describe to us by way of these outcome instruments how the impairment impacts their ability to perform various activities. And most of these symptom questionnaires are specifically described in the AMA guides. For example, the AMA guides describe the pain-related impairment questionnaire as an important symptom questionnaire that we use. And specifically, that symptom questionnaire is used for the determination of pain-related impairments. The AMA guides describe the Beck Depression Inventory, the Beck Anxiety Scale, the Hamilton Rating Scale for Anxiety, the Zung Self-Rating Depression Scale, the McGill Pain Questionnaire, and the Hamilton Self-Rating Scale for Depression. And those are some symptom questionnaires that the guides specifically mention by name. So those are symptom questionnaires that you can use with confidence knowing that they're specifically described in the AMA guides. But those are not the only symptom questionnaires upon which you can rely. There are many other symptom questionnaires as well, including, for example, the Roland Morris Low Back Pain and Disability Questionnaire, the West Haven Yale Multidimensional Pain Inventory, Pain Disability Index, the Pain Drawing Diagram, the Cat's Hand Diagram, the Neck Disability Index, the Revised Oswestry Low Back Questionnaire, and all these different symptom questionnaires we have available to us to use as instruments to allow the examinee to indicate to us by way of peer-reviewed questionnaires that are reliable and valid. This is a way that they can share with us the impact of their impairment on their ability to perform various activities. Now, many doctors do not use these symptom questionnaires, and many doctors do not have these symptom questionnaires. Well, I want you to know that we have these symptom questionnaires available for you at no charge on our website. If you go to easyqmeceu.com, there's an icon there that clearly states symptom questionnaires, and all of these symptom questionnaires are available there in PDF format, and you can download those and you can implement those symptom questionnaires in your very next evaluation. So the symptom questionnaires need to be provided to the examinee during the face-to-face evaluation. And some doctors simply send the examinee a series of symptom questionnaires, whether they're related to the condition or not, to the examinee prior to the physical examination. And some doctors provide these symptom questionnaires prior to the evaluation as the examinee is completing other forms in the waiting room. And it's my opinion that this absolutely needs to be done during the face-to-face evaluation. And let me give you several reasons why that's so. Number one, you as the doctor need to describe each questionnaire to the examinee in advance of their reading the questionnaire to explain the purpose of the questionnaire. It's only after you completely explain the purpose of each questionnaire to the examinee does the examinee know what they're supposed to do, and do they know how they're supposed to complete the questionnaire. Only you as the doctor can explain to the examinee the purpose of these questionnaires and how they are to complete these questionnaires in order to come up with findings on questionnaires that are an accurate representation of the impact of their impairment on their ability to perform functional activities. And then finally, and perhaps most importantly, the completion of the symptom questionnaires by the examinee needs to be an interactive process wherein you as the doctor are involved with them in completing these questionnaires. Now, that doesn't mean that you read each question to them and read each answer option to them and painstakingly go through every sentence with them, but you need to explain to them the purpose of the questionnaire and how to complete the questionnaire, and you need to be there for the examinee if they have any specific questions that come up during the completion of the questionnaire. This is not something that can be done in the doctor's absence. And then finally, you as the doctor, and only you as the doctor can do this during the face-to-face evaluation, you need to review those symptom questionnaires when the examinee completes those and presents those to you. You need to review those questionnaires for at least two things. First of all, you need to review them and make sure that every item is completed. And many times, examinees, they're nervous, or they're anxious, or they simply overlook one or more of the questions or one or more of the responses. And you need to ensure that the questionnaire is completed. In order for it to be a valid instrument, it needs to be completed, correct? Okay, so you need to review them and make sure that they're complete. And then you as the doctor need to review them also and make sure that they're accurate, that the responses to the questions are neither understated or are overstated, that the responses to the questions are consistent, Okay, now, what do the responses to the questions need to be consistent with? Where are some areas that we look for consistency? Well, the responses to the questions on the symptom questionnaire should be consistent with the mechanism of injury. They should be consistent with the medical treatment to date. Should be consistent with known anatomy. Should be consistent with the person who presents sitting in front of you. Should be consistent with the findings on diagnostic studies. And so there's all these different assessments for consistency. And many times, the examinees don't know their role in completing these symptom questionnaires, and so you as the doctor need to review their responses for accuracy and consistency. And let me give you an example on this, and this might seem like a trite example, but I'm sure it's an example that all of you can relate to. If we consider an examinee who suffered a lower back injury, and we're questioning them about the impact of the lower back pain on their activities of daily living, well, one of the symptom questionnaires that we'll want to provide that examinee would be, for example, the Revised Oswestry Low Back Pain Questionnaire. And I'm sure you've probably heard of this questionnaire, and you probably even use this questionnaire. So you're going to be familiar with this example. And that is, on that questionnaire, it asks the examinee to describe the impact of their lower back pain on their ability to sit. And let's just say, for example, that the examinee checks the box that states that because of their back pain, they're not able to sit for greater than 30 minutes. And yet, during the interview, at this point in the interview, you've been able to observe the examinee to sit for, let's say, 60 minutes. And they seem apparently comfortable with sitting for 60 minutes. So you would then review that questionnaire for consistency, and then coming to the section involving sitting, you would note an inconsistency between their response on the questionnaire and your observation of them during the interview. So you would then work with the examinee to come up with a correct answer that's a true representation of their condition on that specific question. And that would look like something like follows. And this is just a sample script. You can use your own script, but this is just an example. You might say, well, Mrs. Jones, I notice here when considering sitting, you indicated here that you're not able to sit beyond 30 minutes. Is that what you meant? And Mrs. Jones might respond, well, yes, that's what I meant. And you as the doctor could simply state, well, Mrs. Jones, we've been in the interview so far for approximately 60 minutes, and I noticed that you've been able to sit comfortably, mostly comfortably, for greater than 60 minutes. And yet here you indicate that you're not able to sit greater than 30 minutes. And Mrs. Jones might say, well, I can sit for greater than 30 minutes, but at 30 minutes, I have pain. And you would work with the examinee to come up with the proper answer on that question. And the script might simply go as follows. Well, Mrs. Jones, even though you have pain at 30 minutes, it does not interfere with your ability to sit 60 minutes, correct? In fact, I've observed you to be able to sit now for 60 minutes. So that's what the question is after, Mrs. Jones. It's not after whether or not you have pain, but it's after whether or not you can sit. And you would work with the examinee to come up with the proper answer on the questionnaire. That's an accurate answer to the question that accurately reflects the impact of the condition on their ability to perform various activities. In this case, the activity that we're concerned with is sitting. So this can only be done in the face-to-face evaluation with the examinee. And if you've ever been into deposition, like I have many times, it's not very long before the parties ask to take a look at the symptom questionnaires. And they call into question the subjectivity and the veracity of symptom questionnaires. And for example, a defense attorney might ask a question such as, well, doctor, isn't it true that the responses on these symptom questionnaires are completely subjective and have are completely unverifiable? And you could simply state, well, that may be true in some cases for some of these activities of daily living. However, I did review each question personally with the examinee, and we together came up with answers to the questions that I believe, within reasonable medical probability, are an accurate representation of the examinee's condition. You can run the mile, you can walk straight through hell with a smile, you could be the hero. And the fact that you can state that you personally reviewed these documents with the examinee renders your opinions and renders your report that much more credible and that much more persuasive. And remember, the title of this program that we talked about in the beginning is The 21 Secrets of the Most Persuasive QMEs. And that's what we're all after, is we're after producing opinions and conclusions that are persuasive and that are an accurate representation of the facts as you know them to the best of your knowledge and within reasonable medical probability. And that's the very best that we can do. So that's how we do the symptom questionnaires. And then component number two of the activities of daily living assessment involves what is called the Activities of Daily Living Interview. And it's the interview regarding activities of daily living that forms an integral part of your interview, your face-to-face interview with the examinee, and sometimes greater than 50% of the total time involved in interviewing the examinee is involved with discovering the impact of their impairment on their ability to perform activities of daily living. So this needs to be done in the face-to-face evaluation by means of an interview. And the activities of daily living interview needs to be done separately and distinctly and entirely for each separate body part involved with the claim for industrial injury. So, for example, if you have an examinee who's claiming an injury to the cervical spine and also an injury to the right knee, let's say, for example, you would go through the entire activities of daily living interview, first of all, related to the cervical spine. And then in a separate cycle of action, you would then repeat the activities of daily living interview as relates to the right knee. So I want to share with you a couple of nuances and a couple of thoughts and considerations as relates to the activities of daily living interview. And the activities of daily living that we're concerned with are described in table 1.2 of the AMA guides. And there's 8 categories that the AMA guides consider to be important activities of daily living. And you need to be fairly fluent with the categories and also the activities, or we should say the sub-activities, contained within each of those categories. Okay, so the 8 categories of activities of daily living include self-care and personal hygiene, communication activities, physical activities, non-specialized hand activities, travel activities, sexual function activities, sleep activities, and sensory function activities. Okay, so let's repeat those. We have the self-care and personal hygiene, communication, physical activities, sensory functions, travel activities, sexual activities, sleep activities, and non-specialized hand activities. And each one of those categories of activities of daily living have several examples of different types of activities that the examinee may be involved with throughout a typical day. So the activities of daily living assessment involves you as the doctor going down through each one of those separate activities and each one of those categories and inquiring to your examinee about the impact of their impairment on their ability to perform these common activities of daily living. And so, for example, the activities of daily living assessment script would go something as follows. And this is just sample script. You can use your own script. But for example, it would go like this. Mrs. Jones, we're now at the point in the evaluation where I want to ask you a few questions about the impact of your lower back pain on your ability to perform various activities of daily living. And we call this portion of the evaluation, we call this the activities of daily living assessment. So I'm going to ask you about several various activities that you might do in a typical day. And I want you to think about how your lower back pain impacts your ability to perform these various activities, if at all, if it even does impact it. Some activities I'll explain to you or describe to you, your back pain might not affect the activity at all. And other activities, you may be completely unable to do because of the pain in your back. So I'm going to give you a list of various activities, and I want you to tell me how your back pain interferes with your ability to perform those activities. Okay? You understand? Understand the philosophy behind the questioning? Okay, good. Okay, so Mrs. Jones, the first category of activities that I want to ask you about is what we call the self-care and personal hygiene activities. Self-care and personal hygiene activities, okay? So, Mrs. Jones, let me ask you, as a result of your lower back pain, do you have any difficulty with using the bathroom for urination? And you wait for the response. And responses are many and varied, and you handle it appropriately. Mrs. Jones, because of your back pain, do you have any difficulty using the bathroom for defecation? Do you have any difficulty brushing your teeth by yourself? Do you have any difficulty with combing your hair? Do you have any difficulty with bathing? Any difficulty with dressing yourself? With any difficulty with eating? Mrs. Jones, with regards to self-care and personal hygiene, can you think of any other example as to illustrate how your back pain interferes with your ability to care for your personal needs? And you elicit the responses, and responses are many and varied. And what you're after is you're after an accurate description as to how the back pain interferes with their ability to perform self-care and personal hygiene activities. And let me give you an example. A common example that we encounter with lower back pain cases involves a person who reports some difficulty with using the bathroom for defecating. So, for example, I would say, do you have any difficulty using the bathroom for defecating? And the examinee may respond, well, yes, I do. In fact, because of the pain in my back, I have difficulty with twisting to wipe myself. I have difficulty with my hygiene after defecating. Okay? So the follow-up question to that you as the doctor would employ to discover how the back pain actually interferes with the activity would be something similar to the following. Okay, Mr. Jones, I understand. You have pain in your back when you twist around to clean up. Is that correct? Yes, that's correct. Okay, Mr. Jones, can you clean up? Can you wipe yourself? Can you perform your own hygiene after using the toilet for defecation? And Mr. Jones will probably say something like, well, yeah, I can. I just twist slowly, or it takes me an extra wipe to get clean, or something like that that reveals that while they may have pain in their back when they perform the activity, the pain does not actually interfere with the activity. And so really, the back pain that they're reporting does not adversely impact that particular activity of daily living. And that would suggest that at least for that activity, the back pain that they're having is not impairing. And this concept of non-impairing pain harkens back to the earlier disability rating schedule that we used prior to the adoption of the AMA guides in 2005. For those of you that have been doing qualified medical evaluations prior to 2005, you'll remember that we used to use the 1997 disability rating schedule. And in the 1997 Permanent Disability Rating Schedule, we had the concept of the subjective factors of disability. And the subjective factors of disability basically involved four different levels of pain. We had minimal pain, slight pain, moderate pain, and severe pain. And those different levels of pain basically described increasing impact of the pain on the ability to perform activities, and specifically the activities that are the cause of the pain. So for example, and by definition, a minimal pain, is pain that is a nuisance and is an annoyance, but does not adversely impact the activity that causes the pain. So, for example, in this case, the examinee states that with twisting around to perform his hygiene, he has pain in the back. And yet if he twists slowly or he's just very deliberate about it, he can actually complete the task. That is an example of minimal pain. Now, minimal pain is a lot different from moderate or severe pain, which significantly adversely impact the activity. So an example of moderate or severe pain would be a person who attempts to clean up and yet, gets a sharp pain, and the pain prevents or adversely interferes with the activity. So in this example, with regards to self-care and personal hygiene, the examinee does have some pain, but the pain does not really interfere with the activity. And so that's the self-care and personal hygiene. And if you think about it, what kind of image do you get in your mind when you think of a person who is significantly impaired in self-care and personal hygiene? What do you think the authors of the AMA guides had in mind when they were envisioning a person who has difficulty, for example, dressing oneself? How would an examinee who has bona fide difficulty in dressing himself, how would they present during the interview and the physical examination? This is a person who's dressed by another person, by a second person. That second person puts this person's clothes on, puts their socks on, puts their shoes on. This type of person is going to present with significant positive objective findings, correct? Okay? So it's true that consistency goes in both directions. Physical exam findings, positive, significant physical exam losses, loss of function, loss of use, or derangement of body parts are going to cause significant limitations in activities of daily living. And those two findings are going to be consistent. Well, similarly, if we know a person has significant limitations in activities of daily living, in other words, they're not able to use the bathroom for defecation, they're not able to dress themselves, they're not able to bathe themselves, we can expect that that person is going to have matching and correlating and significant positive objective findings that both paint the same picture and that both are consistent with each other. So this is the purpose of the Activities of Daily Living Assessment interview, and this is the necessity of performing this interview in the face-to-face evaluation so that you can come up with an accurate construct of the person's true permanent impairment, and you can assign an accurate permanent impairment percentage that truly and accurately describes their functional limitations. Okay? Now, it's true that many of these activities of daily living that are described in Table 1.2 are completely subjective. And I've had this issue raised at deposition many times, and the attorney will say, well, doctor, isn't it true that these activities of daily living are completely subjective and non-verifiable? And the answer to that question is, well, yes, many of them are. And for example, we have no way to be able to verify if the examinee has difficulty in using the bathroom, or difficulty with bathing themselves, or difficulty with sexual functions, or difficulty with sleep functions. In other words, we can't go into the examinee's bedroom and objectively verify through our doctor's eyes that indeed there are difficulty with sexual functions. So many of these activities of daily living descriptions are completely subjective. That's why you as the doctor are required to investigate all significant limitations that the examinee reports to you to provide the detail that supports the limitation. Now, some of these activities are activities that we can directly observe in the face-to-face meeting with the injured worker, such as the physical activities. The physical activities include include standing, sitting, reclining, walking and climbing stairs. And so it's during the physical activities, for example, or the activities that we can observe, that we get a sense for the examinee's consistency. In other words, the examinee's descriptions of limitations on these activities that we can observe give us a barometer and a gauge for assessing their credibility on their responses to the questions for activities that we can observe. And let me illustrate that. So if, for example, the examinee reports to us that they're not able to sit for 30 minutes, and yet we've observed them to be able to sit comfortably for 60 minutes or 90 minutes or 2 hours, that indicates that perhaps they're overstating or overperceiving their impairment, and it suggests that perhaps some of the other answers may also be overstated or overperceived, and that would be some areas that you, as the doctor, would want to explore in order to come up with accurate answers. So that's how we handle that. Couple more comments about some of these activities of daily living. Some of these activities of daily living suggest very specific injuries in the presence of functional limitations. So for example, with the communication activities. The communication activities involve writing, typing, seeing, hearing, speaking, and other. What would be involved with other? Well, how about email messaging or text messaging or perhaps even sign language for a deaf person? All of these are involved with communication activities. Now, for example, for somebody that had difficulty with the communication activities of hearing and speaking, what type of an injury would you expect this person to present with? That describes a very limited number of injuries, correct, that leave the examinee with functional limitations with difficulty speaking and hearing, correct? That would suggest some sort of a nervous system injury, whether it be a central nervous system injury, a peripheral nervous system injury. In other words, there's a very specific neurologic injury here that leaves a person with difficulty speaking and hearing. And so this functional limitation should be accompanied by specific physical examination findings. And it's interesting because our findings on activities of daily living interview help to drive our physical examination. And so in this example, the person who presents with difficulty speaking and hearing is going to then get a very thorough cranial nerve examination, correct? And a very thorough neurologic examination, correct? And so you need to be prepared to specifically examine for findings that suggest certain injuries. Certain findings on your activities of daily living interview are going to drive your physical examination procedures. And in this case, we would be concerned with injury to the brain or perhaps even the brain stem or the specific peripheral cranial nerves themselves. Okay? Sensory function activities, those are mostly related to the special senses of hearing, seeing, tasting, smelling, and touching. And so for examinees who report difficulties with the sensory functions, again, we would be involved or concerned with injury to the central nervous system or the peripheral nervous system. We would not expect to have an examinee report difficulty with hearing and speaking in the presence of a musculoskeletal injury, such as a lower extremity injury. But you'd be surprised how many times examinees do not understand the purpose of this interview, and they fill these forms out incorrectly. And that's another illustration as to why this needs to be done in the face-to-face evaluation. These questions specifically relate to the injury of concern related to the industrial injury. Okay? Okay, and then just a couple more comments. With regards to travel activities, the travel activities are described as riding in a car, driving a car, and traveling by plane, in other words, flying. So many times examinees will report difficulty with travel activities, specifically driving. And one of the ways to arrive at an accurate answer to this assessment is to determine whether or not the examinee actually drove themselves to your evaluation. Many times examinees will report difficulty with driving when indeed the evidence indicates that they were able to successfully drive themselves to your appointment and arrive on time. And this is suggestive of high level of physical function and probably minimal impact of the condition on the ability to drive themselves. Now, similarly, the flying activities or the ability to travel by plane is something that is frequently misunderstood by examinees. So a good way to approach this assessment is to ask the examinee, very simply, have you had the opportunity to fly recently, to travel by plane recently? And many times the examinee will state that indeed they did. They recently took a trip to Hawaii, or they took a trip to Las Vegas, or they took a trip to New Orleans, or whatever. And if you, as the doctor, think back and remember back to the last time you were at an airport, and we've all been to the airport, and when you think about getting through the airport, the ability to get through the airport and actually get on a plane and travel to your destination is suggestive of a high level of physical function. For example, you have to be able to get from long-term parking or even short-term parking to the concourse, and that involves getting up and down on the shuttle and traveling across the property. And then once you're in the concourse, you have to be transported substantial distance to get to your gate. And you have to pass through security where you take off your shoes and socks and your belt and carry your luggage and travel great distances and wait great times. And sometimes if you think about what it takes to travel by plane, that's suggestive of high level of physical function. Now, I want you to picture in your mind someone who has bona fide difficulty in traveling by plane. And you've all been to the airport and you've seen those people that get transported on the transport cart, right? Or they're pushed along by an attendant in a wheelchair. And these people always go to the front of the line. They're the first ones to board the plane so that they can get the closest seats up front, and we've all seen those people. And this is the type of image that should come to your mind when you think about bona fide difficulty in traveling by plane. Now, many people will say that it was difficult, and I agree that getting through an airport can be difficult, but that's perhaps suggestive that any difficulty is minimal, and just the fact that the examinee was able to travel back and forth to Hawaii or New Orleans or whatever is suggestive of a high level of physical function. And this is the type of work that you want to do with the examinee to come up with accurate responses to these questions. With regards to sexual functions, and then we'll conclude this program after this section, these sexual functions involve two basic activities. One is normal sexual function for male and female. And normal sexual function for a female involves lubrication and orgasm. And then normal sexual function for male involves erection and ejaculation. So that's the first category of activities that the AMA guides are concerned with. The second category of activities involves pain during sex itself. So when questioning for the impact of any particular impairment on the sexual function activities, your line of questioning may go as follows. And this is just sample script. Okay, Mrs. Jones, I'm now going to ask you some questions about sexual functions. And I want you to tell me how your back pain, if at all, interferes with your sexual functions. So first of all, let me ask you, do you have normal female sexual function? For example, do you have normal lubrication and normal orgasm? And I want you to think in your mind, what type of an injury would you expect an examinee to present with that then creates a functional limitation adversely impacting lubrication and orgasm? You would expect that this person would have some type of an injury involving either the parasympathetic nervous system or the sympathetic nervous system, perhaps a cauda equina syndrome or a lumbar spine herniated disc. In other words, a person with these types of functional limitations is going to have a very specific injury that should be accompanied by associated and consistent and correlating positive objective findings on physical examination. And most examinees will tell you, well, yes, I do. I have normal sexual female sexual function. And the males will tell you, yes, I do have normal erection and I do have normal ejaculation. And then the next line of questioning would involve pain during sex. And so the line of questioning perhaps would go as follows. Okay, well, Mrs. Jones, do you have pain with sex? Or in other words, does the lower back pain that you're having in any way interfere with your ability to have sex? And the examinee may respond as follows. They may say, well, yes, certain positions do cause me to have pain with sex. And you would simply explore that by asking them, well, Mrs. Jones, are you able to have sex? Or are you not able to have sex? And most times the examinee will report to you that, well, yeah, I am able to have sex. I just make sort of certain modifications and it works out okay. And this would be an example that any pain during sex, which is completely unverifiable, is probably minimal pain at most and does not significantly interfere with the activity that causes pain and does not significantly contribute towards a permanent impairment rating. So, doctors, that's a couple of illustrations as to how you can use the activities of daily living assessment. And that's some examples as to how the very best evaluators perform the activities of daily living assessment. And let's just review some of the high points that we talked about. Number one is that the activities of daily living assessment needs to be a formalized and thorough procedure. It needs to be done in the face-to-face evaluation with the injured worker and not simply performed as an afterthought and not simply done by having the examinee check a series of boxes on forms or questionnaires. It needs to be done formally in the face-to-face evaluation where you as the doctor are interactive with the examinee in helping them to come up with accurate responses to the questions. And that illustrates the third point is that you as the doctor need to work with the examinee to help them understand the purpose of the questions and the responses to the questions and help them come up with responses that are a true reflection of their current condition. And in this way, you as the doctor can create a credible report and a credible permanent impairment rating that isn't accurate, that's not overstated, it's not understated, it's an actual true representation of their current condition. And it's a accurate representation that you are willing to stand behind by way of your own further testimony and supplemental report and even at deposition. In other words, you put forward an opinion that you are confident in and that you are persuaded yourself is accurate, that you then convey with persuasiveness to the parties, and that you are willing to defend when that opinion is challenged. And this is how the most persuasive and most respected evaluators in the whole state approach this issue of permanent impairment ratings and the activities of daily living assessment. So, doctors, I hope that helps you. This is Dr. Perry Carpenter. I look forward to being with you on future videos. And for now, hope you enjoyed today's program. And I conclude by letting you know I'm wishing you the very best of success in your career as a qualified medical evaluator. Do it for your country, do it for your name, 'cause there's gonna be a day when you're